got quiet in here. Are we starting this ourselves?
We are.
No training wheels. Good morning, everybody. Thanks for being here with us bright and early. And for those who are watching via streaming or any other technology, thanks to you, IndyCar and IMS fans, for joining us from far away. This morning, we are delighted to announce the first sellout in the history of the Indianapolis 500-mile race. All suites, reserve seats, and infield general admission tickets for the 100th running of the Indianapolis 500, presented by Penn Grade Motor Oil, are sold out. There's no event in the world like the Indianapolis 500-mile race, and this sellout is a testament to the enduring legacy of the greatest spectacle in racing, the thrilling racing of the Verizon IndyCar Series, and the bright future for both. Second part of this announcement is this. With no way to accommodate more fans here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway on race day, we're also announcing that we will suspend the television delay in Indianapolis, making it possible for those who can't be with us on race day to watch the 100th running live. The traditional delayed coverage on WRTV will also continue, so fans who attend the race will be able to go home with their families and watch the broadcast again on Sunday evening. I want to thank all our fans for making this possible, and I want to thank ABC, WRTV, and MS Broadcasting, which presents the live radio broadcast in Indianapolis, for working with us on these arrangements. Doug?
Thank you, Mark. This is a pretty exciting day for all of us here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. I think first I'd like to thank a wonderful team here at the Speedway. It's a group of people that have actually worked really, really hard over the last 365 days to lead into this 100th running of the Indianapolis 500. Many 24-hour days, especially here in the last few weeks as we've gone through a lot of construction, but more importantly, trying to reach out to fans all over the state to talk to them about the importance of this Hoosier event. Donald Davidson, Mike Harmless, others have been in 92 counties. We've actually touched all 92 counties leading up to this point, and we're just really excited about the enthusiasm and the support that not only Indianapolis, but the entire state of Indiana has given the Indianapolis Motor Speedway as we've gone forward. This is much more, I think, than any of us had ever expected when we started this march last year, about a year from today, when we unveiled the logo over on Main Street in the town of Speedway. You know, as we sit back and we think about how important history and tradition is to the Speedway, and we often, as we lead into this 100th running, think about Carl Fisher. And what would Carl Fisher, the crazy promoter, think about where we were today? I think Carl Fisher would be really excited about this opportunity. Not that we've sold it out as much as we're giving everyone an opportunity who can't be here as well to experience what's going to be so wonderful on Sunday in just a few days from now here at the Speedway. You know, I was looking back in some of the records, and one of the great things about this event is how people have embraced it. The first race in 1911 had 80,000 people attend it. And right before World War II, we had as many as 170,000 people in this venue. This is a venue that's hosted millions and millions of people over its 100 runnings. And we can't wait to host those that are coming through the gates this Sunday, as well as those that will be watching it at home on TV in this market because they can't get here. A few things that are I wanted to touch base on. We're going to get questions today about tickets. So many people, especially in the Snake Pit, which is sold out, but many of those Snake Pit folks have purchased Snake Pit wristbands. But in order to get in the Snake Pit, you also have to have a GA ticket. So for those folks who have a Snake Pit wristband but not a GA ticket, we'll begin to make accommodations for them to make sure that they come. Those folks who have parking passes inside the Indianapolis Motor Speedway but have waited to buy your GA ticket until you know how many people are coming in your car with you, we will also have a way for you to be accommodated to make sure that we get you in the Indianapolis Motor Speedway on race day. Another question that I got this morning actually is, if you have GA tickets as parents and you're planning to bring your 12 and under free to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, we still will accommodate your 12 and under free kids getting in on race day. So there are some ways that we're going to take care of some customers who may have been waiting for last minute, who have already purchased certain items or were planning on bringing folks that were 12 and under free to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Mostly this is a day for all of us to celebrate as Hoosiers and celebrate this great community. This does not happen. We don't sell out our reserve seats. We don't sell out our infield. We don't allow the delay to be live without the great support of this community and everybody here in the state of Indiana. We're just really proud to be here.
Questions?
Mike.
Doug, would you then say that this would be the largest attended event going back to 1995, being the last benchmark like this?
Believe it or not, our records are difficult to really make sure we can make a definitive comment there. The way I've always couched it is this will be the largest crowd, or will feel like those crowds we experienced in the late 80s and the early 90s. Our records that we feel really confident talking about don't quite go back far enough for us to say that, but it's certainly the largest crowd that has been here in a couple of decades.
Guys,
it's such a huge crowd coming. What do you want fans to keep in mind?
So one of the things we're going to do at 2 o'clock today, we're going to have an operations briefing, and we're going to lay out a lot of that for everybody so we know what they want. There's three simple words, I think, that we can think about that are really important. Early, and I can say that 20 times, early, plan, and be really patient. But we'll talk more about that today at 2 o'clock.
Bob? Yeah. Can you briefly sketch out why in the past there has been a blackout, the rationale for that, and how did you determine how many human beings you can get into the infield?
Yeah, those are both fair questions, good questions. This place, I think, is unlike really any other modern sporting event insofar as it is so dependent on the gate or the paid attendance here at the Speedway. It is a vast place, and that is just a fundamentally important part of the business model for the event, much more so than television and the television rights revenues. So as a business matter, the reality is that I think we have a different model, and I think that the previously and today we have to be vigilant about making the economy of the event work, and that requires protecting the gate. So we were able to make this decision today for today by thinking about what does it mean to be sold out in the infield. Obviously, it's not like reserve seats or suites where there's a fix, you can go count, right? There's a fixed number of places you can put people, seats that are reserved that people can buy. Not the case in the infield. So for us, it was just an ongoing daily analysis to look at what's the appropriate number of people to sell general admission tickets to for the infield and to make the decision to cut it off when we think we got to that place. We've looked at every data point we can from, and again, later this afternoon there'll be more discussion about extra arrangements that have already been made, from more lanes to get people through gates and an earlier perimeter in some gates to check coolers so that people can use express lanes. But with all that in mind, we felt like if we kept selling through race day, after now, we might sell another 30,000+ people or tickets. And think about that, another 30,000 people on top of the size of this crowd, we just felt like was not appropriate.
One quick follow-up, is this a one-time only deal, or if 3 years from now you're in a position to sell out again, might you revisit this?
Well, I think our feeling and our board's feeling was that under the circumstances where we cannot accommodate more people here at the Speedway to take in the race, it makes sense to make it available through live TV. Whether that's a unique situation or not, time will tell. It certainly didn't hurt that it was the 100th running of the Indianapolis 500-mile race. But, so we haven't made a we do not anticipate live coverage in Indianapolis again. But certainly, if there is a sellout again, it would be considered. Yes.
How many people do you think will be here inside of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway on Sunday?
So you know we don't answer that question. I will tell you that it's a whole lot more than were here last year. And one way that we've been thinking about this is you could take, roughly speaking, this is not precise, so if you go do the math, you won't be exactly right, but you can take the population of Fort Wayne, Indiana, and the population of South Bend, Indiana, the whole of the two cities, put them together, and something of that order of magnitude will be here on race day. That knocked out all the rest of the questions.
Not quite. For Mr. Miles, with the understanding that there are countless operational hurdles to execute and take care of this weekend, but for you to sit here today and announce a complete total sellout of the event, does this in any way compare to great moments you might have experienced as Super Bowl chairman or Pan Am games or even an ATP? Or is this like a unique high point for your career?
Well, in no way do I think about it in terms of my career or for me, quite frankly. I haven't, but it would be hard for me to kind of compare, say, Pan Am games to Super Bowl to this. Except that for all of them, the community's response has been stunning. They're all different. They're different orders of complexity. So I don't know. You know, it's not about how I feel about it. I do think the community response has been unbelievable, and that's been true in each of those three big occasions.
Are there some ways that you think you can help grow the fan base by doing this? I mean, the Chicago Blackhawks for years and years were not on TV. They got on TV. They also got good. That helped a lot. But you know, it really grew their fan base and got the young people involved and created a whole new generation of hockey fans. Could it have that impact on race fans?
You know, again, I think we've tried to lay out why our thinking about the delay in Indianapolis is what it is. We make a lot of effort to reach out to people of all stripes, including kids under 12 free, including the Snake Pit, which is taken off. We have to cut that off at about 30,000 people. Those are kids, right? Or maybe they don't want to be called kids, but they're millennials. And they're here on race day. And we think, well, we got a pretty good shot at converting them to race fans when EDM or whatever genre maybe has less appeal to them in their later years. So we do a lot to reach out. And honestly, Bob, I think this is about Indianapolis, right? The Indianapolis ADI. And you have to live under a rock in this community, as you all know, not to be confronted almost with the fact of May and all the different ways that people of all ages can participate. So I certainly don't feel like we work very hard to be accessible and to engage the community at all age levels. And I don't think we're depriving ourselves of that opportunity vis-a-vis the television issue.
Okay. There's no doubt the 100 running is drawing a lot of attention, but how do you guys keep the momentum going next year and the year after that to continue to generate these types of crowds?
You know, one of the things that's really unique about the Indianapolis 500 is it's special every year. So, and that's why people continue to come back, and that's why we can't walk around the grounds of the Speedway without being stopped by somebody to tell us how many times they've come and how long their streak is. The 100th has given us another platform to re-engage fans who maybe have left for a while and are coming back and to bring new fans in. And I think once we get people here, that captures them. There's something more than just a race that makes this place special, and we have to continue to do that. We are focused on trying to continue to grow this sport. We aren't viewing this as an endpoint or a reason to look back. The 100th running for us is a reason to look forward. We have to celebrate what makes us special, which is our tradition, but we're using this as a springboard to go forward. Does the 100th give us an opportunity to talk all year round? Absolutely. But we still believe that this is a way to continue to go forward and continue to grow this brand into the next century. So we're really focused on that. The team is already starting to think about how are we going to make sure we engage people in the renewal process, which begins at midnight on Sunday when the Indy 500 completes, and then how do we make sure that we maintain that momentum and noise, not just in the marketplace, but throughout the country. I've had an opportunity to talk to customers every evening when I drive home, and there are people who are going to continue to come back, and the 100th was an opportunity for them as longtime fans to bring others back into the fold. And I think once we get people here, people want to stay. So we're gonna work hard on it, and we're not stopping on May 29th. On May 30th, we're going to start going full blast in the 101st.
I think there's likely to be a briefing tomorrow. Is that still true on that and the plans for the 101st will begin to be unveiled? And it isn't that we just started thinking about this. This has been top of mind and planned for a very long time. It's an opportunity to build on the, 70 to 100,000 people, more people that'll be here this year than were here last year, and make sure they have a great experience and make sure they want to be back because it works the way Doug suggested. Other questions?
You
You guys had mentioned 49 and 50 being the last times this thing was live. Do you have any idea why it was live back in those years? Miles, you were old enough to
remember. I am not. If the last year was 1950, I'm happy to report I do not know from personal experience, and we have yet to be able to get an explanation. We don't even have the record. We understand it from our friends at ABC that was the case.
I talked to Jeff Smullyan last night. How did that discussion go? And I know you're not going to get into the business sense, but the radio broadcast is a really big deal financially. How do you work through that?
We work through it. Jeff Smullyan is a friend and a community-minded citizen and the head of an important company at Emmis. And I spoke to him the night before last, and I spoke to him again this morning. And the relationship is as close as it ever has been, and we will sit down and work through it. But it's worth noting, I meant to thank them, I hope I did, that the radio broadcast is very, very important to us, even here at the track. Who knows how many thousands, tens of thousands of people are listening to the radio broadcast and through the app, the Verizon IndyCar app. So it is an important way to reach people, and it's people in their cars who can't watch an image and all the rest of it. So it will continue to be important for us to the extent that this unanticipated development surprised us and him and his customers. We're going to sit down and work through it with them.
Was that the biggest hurdle you had to clear?
I think from a commercial perspective, yeah. I never felt like that would be something we couldn't work through, given the relationship with Emmis in this community. But I think there were bigger hurdles than the commercial ones. Really, there's no blueprint here to decide whether you want to sell another 30,000 tickets for the infield. That I think the group, the team, has just done a remarkable job of looking at it from every perspective, from looking at aerials from last year and prior years to say, where is the green space and could we put more people here? Or is it a good idea to put more people here? And all that analysis, late nights, early mornings, and uppermost in everybody's mind was making sure we made the appropriate decision and that we do the best we can to make sure that race fans want to come back. Yeah.
With this being such a significant year, the 100th running, did you guys actually anticipate a sellout crowd? And if not, how are you now managing to, I guess, make sure this all goes smooth and hire your staff? What's going on?
It's fair to say a lot of people anticipated a sellout of the reserve seats, but I don't think people anticipated getting to the place where we'd have to say we really should not sell additional infield general admission tickets. So that's kind of the newest development. We never really acknowledged that we'd definitely sell out the reserve seats until later in the game when we could clearly see the demand. What was the second part of your question? Oh, the plans have assumed that, though, for a long time. And we're almost to the point where it's difficult to find anybody else who can don a yellow shirt or work for the private security people. They're coming in, they're being imported from out of the state already. So there really are some limits to what can be done, and I think we've done everything possible to run this event with this crowd the way we want to see it happen. Mike.
Did Homeland Security provide any guidance on capping, you know, your further sales?
No. The Homeland Security and any number of federal agencies are very involved in the planning. And Mike Bates, who's over here, recent former deputy chief of IMPD, is now on our executive team and is involved in every step of the analysis. And but it's never been our experience that any agency, except maybe there's probably one, is likely to say stop. It's not a confined space like you'd expect for building for fire marshals and the like. So no, nobody told us what the right answer was. We just tried to do the right thing ourselves.
Given recent world events, is there any enhanced security that you're putting in place here?
Yes, a lot of which won't be expressly detailed, but some of it will be talked about in this afternoon's first discussion of logistics. Okay. Thank you all for all the work you do to cover this event. We'll see you daily.
Just encourage everybody at home that's gonna that won't be here for race day, host a porch party, invite your neighbors, turn on the TV, watch the Indianapolis 500, and tweet at us photos of you guys enjoying the 100th running of the Indy 500 presented by Pengrade. It's going to be a great time in Indianapolis on Sunday. Thank you.
A final plea there from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway president, Doug Bowles, who says that now you can host your watch parties because the Indianapolis 500 will be broadcast live on Sunday.
They just got to a point with ticket sales, they just couldn't justify stuffing in another 30,000 people and selling 30,000 more tickets. So they decided to lift that blackout and air it live here on RTV6 starting at 11 o'clock. We'll be live on air, though, starting at 5 a.m. for Breakfast at the Brickyard.
That's right. You watched RTV6 live coverage of that huge announcement that they are lifting the blackout and will air the race live on APC and here on RTV6. Here's a lineup of what you can expect to see this Sunday. We're up with you bright and early starting at 5 a.m. until 11 a.m. for Breakfast at the Brickyard.
That's right. Starting at 11, that's when ABC takes over and brings you live track coverage, and then the race starts at 12. That runs until 3:30, and then our Trackside 6 post-race special starts at 3:30, runs to 7.
That's right, and then join us for a special replay of the Indianapolis 500 that runs from 7 to 11:30 p.m. So if you go to the race and you still want to see it again, we've got you covered. Our